Dr. John Ward. I'm the director of the Coalition for Global Hepatitis Elimination in the United States. And really, it's my pleasure to be kicking off Thinking Big, Hepatitis B and Hepatitis C Elimination in Asia. And truly, I can't think of a better topic to begin the APASL meeting today with, a focus on Hepatitis B and Hepatitis C elimination. There's so many health gains that can be accomplished through Hepatitis B and Hepatitis C elimination in Asia that it fully deserves this level of focus. I want to thank my colleagues at the Coalition, Lindsay Heber and Quincy Williams here for helping bring this together. I want to thank all the speakers that you'll be hearing from in a moment that's going to be sharing their experiences and lessons learned as they seek to expand access to prevention, care, and treatment services for hepatitis B and C to make elimination possible. And I want to thank Gilead Sciences for support of this of convening this meeting. Now, the coalition is convening this meeting in collaboration with APASL, specifically the Task Force for Hepatitis Elimination, that was started within about the last year. And it really has a large number of clinicians and other stakeholders have signed on to that. Dr. George Lau from Hong Kong is a leader of that task force. I know many of you know George. Unfortunately, he is stuck in traffic somewhere between Osaka and Kyoto. So we'll have to hear his opening remarks when he arrives. So I think what I'll do is just go ahead and get started with some slides to warm us up, to describe why we are here today, why hepatitis elimination is so important for Asia. Now, truly, we're not going to achieve goals for hepatitis B or hepatitis C elimination without achievement of those goals in many Asian countries. And that's why we are really framing this as thinking big, because of the large population centers in Asia and the high prevalences in many countries of hepatitis B and hepatitis C. That's George. So what we'll be, and we'll be hearing some opening remarks, as I mentioned, then we'll be hearing from some, as I mentioned, sharing of lessons learned from countries, Japan, China and Australia, and really check in on their progress toward hepatitis elimination. We'll be hearing from Dr. Philippa Easterbrook about some of her perspectives regarding the policies they have in place already for hepatitis B and hepatitis C, some of the treatment guidelines that will be rolled out later this week here at APASL with the collaboration of Dr. Saeed Hamid and others that are in the room here. And then we'll be hearing from a patient perspective from Japan, and then we'll be hearing from some updates from Pakistan, Vietnam, and the Philippines. And then we'll have an opportunity for a wide-ranging discussion that I look forward to having all of you participate in. So let me give you some setting the table remarks, please. These are my disclosures. Yeah. This is what I would like to cover. We're going to be seeking to give you some examples of implementation of hepatitis testing and treatment in particular, as well as some other key prevention initiatives, and really focus on the key role of national commitment to put all of those interventions into place. First of all, hopefully all of you are well acquainted with the large burden of hepatitis B around the world, almost 300 million persons living with chronic hepatitis B infection. Almost two-thirds of those are in the countries of Asia, as defined of the Southeast Asia region and Western Pacific region of WHO. 80% of all deaths occur in the countries in those regions. 1.5 million new infections. Only about 1 in 4 of those are in Asian countries, reflecting the remarkable achievement of high immunization coverage, protecting infants and newborns from hepatitis B infection because they're at highest risk of chronic infection. And the countries of Asia, virtually all, have now achieved the 2020 United Nations Sustainable Development Goal of reducing prevalence to less than 1% among young children because of those vaccine coverage. Of all the Sustainable Development Goals, that was the only one achieved in 2020 was that reduction in prevalence, leading toward that final goal of 0.1% by 2030. For hepatitis C, about 58 million people globally, about half of those persons live in countries of Asia. Pakistan, 10 million persons, almost one in five people with hepatitis C now are in Pakistan. We'll be hearing more about that in a moment. 40% of deaths are in the countries of Asia, and about 30% of new infections, either related to unsafe healthcare, such as the continued use of unsafe injection equipment, or in communities, particularly among people who inject drugs. We also don't want to forget that there's a huge economic downside of a failure to eliminate hepatitis B and hepatitis C, that if things do not change, you have a loss in productivity because of early mortality, disability, life years that are caused by continued hepatitis B and hepatitis C infections, whereby if you do achieve elimination goals, you can actually turn those reductions in economic productivity into gains because of that improved health. And I think that's one of the reasons that the recent G20 meeting called for continued efforts to eliminate hepatitis around the world in their Delhi declaration of the fall of 2023. And one of the activities of the coalition is that we put together with our partners in countries what we call hepatitis elimination profiles, which bring together data regarding the plans, the policies, the programs, and progress toward elimination in countries, so that all of that information can be brought together to understand what's going well and what needs more attention, and sharing lessons learned across countries. So we just wanted to share some of those data with you. We have those profiles for about 12 countries that are here. As far as reaching mortality goals from WHO, it appears that Bangladesh and Philippines are on track to reach 2025 goals for hepatitis B related mortality reductions, with Japan apparently already have reached the 2030 goal. We'll hear more about some of those achievements here in a moment. However, when you look at trends, only two countries have mortality reductions underway. So more work needs to be done for hepatitis B. Mortality reductions for hepatitis C. Japan and the Republic of Korea appears to have met, or approaching to have met, the 2025 goal for WHO, with some reported declines in Chinese Taipei, Japan, and South Korea. So we have variability in progress, but progress is being made in countries of Asia. When we look at studies of hepatitis testing and treatment, the status of hepatitis testing and treatment in Asia, and again, there's wide variability. Unfortunately, almost uniformly, however, there's very low diagnostic rates and treatment rates for hepatitis B in Southeast Asia countries. There's a little bit more positive news when you look at countries such as Korea and Australia, and again, low rates in Pakistan. There are some opportunities to improve hepatitis testing and treatment. The Global Fund recently began to support hepatitis testing for Global Fund eligible countries, for key populations, and for pregnant women. There's now a very low cost of tenofovir available for countries that have affordability issues for medications. And there will be new hepatitis B treatment guidelines coming out from WHO, as I mentioned, with goals for care simplification, decentralization, and expansion of treatment eligibility. There's also a need to continue to strengthen the evidence base for policy development at the country level, and to put together feasible models of care appropriate for countries' health systems. With some of my colleagues in the room today, we had a consultation back in the summer where we put together a roadmap of the research that could help expand access to hepatitis B care and treatment, particularly in low and middle income countries. And I encourage you to click on that QR code to get more information about that. And you'll be hearing more about research from Philippa Easterbrook later in this program today. For hepatitis C, again, we have a variability in the percent of people who have been diagnosed and cured, as you can see here by this slide. Again, we have some notable achievements, such as in Korea, Australia, as well as in Japan, as we'll be hearing more about. But clearly, more work to do to accelerate declines in hepatitis B and hepatitis C-related mortality. I think the other key feature of hepatitis C testing and treatment is that we have the toolkit together to put in place models of care that will expand access to treatment. We were part of a systematic review that Dr. Evan Cunningham of Kirby Institute in Australia put together over the last year or more, identifying those key interventions that can, strategies or technologies that can accelerate access to testing and treatment. So we have that toolkit. Now it's what, how do we put that into place to expand access to testing and treatment? The other access, the other aspect of this is prevention. In particular, for populations at highest risk for HCV, which is persons who inject drugs, they require access to clean injection equipment, as well as access to other harm reduction services, as is listed here on the right. I think it's notable that the data indicate that China, Pakistan, Chinese Taipei have met interim targets for making that clean injection equipment readily available for people who inject drugs. And apparently Myanmar and Bangladesh have even had greater success to reach that 2030 target of WHO that's indicative of good prevention for this high risk population. So again, we have some achievements to build on, to learn from. We just need to make them more uniformly applied and implemented throughout the countries. When I think of, we will be hearing from a number of countries here in a moment about their successes. I did want to point out, one country coming from our National Hepatitis Elimination Profiles for Korea to show their declines in hepatitis B mortality, reflecting their high percentage of people that have been diagnosed and of those that have been put on appropriate treatment based on their national treatment guidelines. The percentage declines in mortality from hepatitis C, again reflecting diagnostic rates and access to treatment. And then the key strategies to make that testing and treatment possible. They have data to track the number of diagnoses and treatment. They have treatment policies based on age criteria, screening for pregnant women, as well as people at risk. They've sought to simplify their care strategies already through their treatment guidelines for both hepatitis B and hepatitis C. They've reduced, but not totally eliminated, the cost of treatment for the citizens of for Korea. They've even gone a step further to begin to have routine liver cancer screening for patients with hepatitis over a certain age. And importantly, they have a public budget line for their hepatitis B, hepatitis C testing treatment program. And that's what we need all countries to have. In many ways, we have the diagnostics, we have the treatments, we have key strategies to make those testing and treatment readily available. What we need now is a national commitment to put all of that into place And at the end of our program today, we're going to be talking about having a call for a national commitment to hepatitis elimination that I encourage you all to join us in signing as a show of solidarity toward this goal of hepatitis B and hepatitis C elimination. Now, to make the point of the consequences of not moving toward hepatitis elimination, we just released today a report on the dire consequences of inaction and calling out countries with high burdens, such as China, India, Pakistan, Vietnam, to begin to emphasize the point of the time for action is now. And the longer we wait, the more unnecessary deaths occur and the more harm to individual health, the health of the communities, and to the economy. And this just gives you some examples of the data from that report to show the value of hepatitis for countries that are listed here. And we'll be getting more into some of these details when we hear from some of these countries here in a moment. One of our jobs as a coalition is to help countries put together these key components of effective hepatitis elimination programs, the value of data, planning, pilot testing to put together feasible, appropriate models of care, a focus on health equity, the value of operational research, again, having data to document when your goals are achieved. And through all of that, we need a focus on political commitment. And that is as important as all the technical know-how. We have to bring that national commitment together. So as we share lessons learned, let's all continue to agree that we need to also have a role in advocacy and sending a clear message that hepatitis elimination is worthwhile and needs to happen as soon as possible in the countries and around the world. So we'll be coming back to that call to action later in our program. Thank you. As we wait for George, it's my great pleasure to introduce my longtime colleague, Dr. Junko Tanaka, who is the Executive Vice President and Medical Policy Office of Hiroshima University in Japan. And I ask Junko to come forward and give her remarks and help us understand the status of hepatitis elimination in Japan. Junko?
Okay. Thank you for introducing me. Good morning. So my name is Junko Tanaka. So I'm very glad to introduce some data from Japan to you. So John, shall we start to the presentation or to some?
You
have slide? Yeah, I have slide.
Just roll.
Yeah, maybe he.
Just roll it forward.
Okay.
Towards you.
Okay. Okay, good morning. So I would like to introduce this HBV-HCV burden of disease and the important screening and care initiatives. So I don't have enough time today, so I want to give a brief data from Japan. So I'm a PI under the Ministry of Health Research Group, Epidemiological Research Group, and I would like to show the concept of the research group is here, collection and analysis of data, and providing epidemiological data, and propose the control, prevention, the countermeasures for the contributing to the elimination of viral hepatitis. And I said core pillars are three, is the burden of the disease, and to clarify the long-term prognosis following after the infection of the hepatitis B, And to clarify the regional level or visualizations of the degree of achievement of these strategies. So this is these are burden and the prognosis, and to clarify the current states of testing uptake and medical institution visit or something, and modeling, and there. So I'd like to show the total number of chronic infection status in Japan since 2000. As you see in the left side is the 2000 for hepatitis B, is 1.3 million people living with hepatitis B. And the 2000 HCV is 1.7. But as for hepatitis C, is dramatically decreased at 2020, 0.4 million only. So because of the efficacy of the DAA. So, and also we found in the Japan's current status compared to the goal, which was set in WHO eliminations. So there's five pillars. So, and you can see the green mark, green face is very good, well going, and the yellow and the red is a little bit. So I have to monitor it, and reporting still continuing. So I would like to introduce the countermeasure or history in Japan. So as you can see, is after the discovery of hepatitis B virus, and mainly I want to say is four milestones. And two of them is as for hepatitis B, is a countermeasure for the mother to child transmissions since 1986. And the mainly is the milestone two. You can see the free hepatitis virus test target is over 40 years old in whole Japan for free. So we can find the infected person since 2002. And you can see the milestone three is a basic act on hepatitis measures. This is role. So we can set the core hospital, every prefecture, so patient can receive the treatment with the high level and the same level. So the four pillars as here, the first infection control and preventions, including the hepatitis B countermeasures. And the second is find and treat patient nationwide, based on the role, and the policy is very important. And four is work with the patient group. So back to the 2000, we estimated the total number of unaware person who is living with hepatitis B, hepatitis C. It means that they don't know they are infected because they never received a test. So you can see the mainly 80% or 75% of them are aged over 40 years old. So we thought that the national screening has to be targeting the age group 40 years old. So it will be effective. So since 2002 in Japan, the national screening has started, targeted 40 years old. And the first 5 years, 8 million people are tested. And at the first 5 years, the positive rate for hepatitis B, hepatitis B is the same 1.2. And then this system is continuing since now. And in total, 20 million people are already tested because of this system. So, and you can see the positivity is now decreasing. So this is the positivity over 40 years old. And it means that the 20 million people is the 25% of all 40 years old population receiving hepatitis virus tests in this system. But you can see the many opportunities to be received. So I wonder what percentage of the population already received the test. So is that at the blood donations, at pregnancy, or at the surgery? So we managed the nationwide survey in 2011, 17, and 20. And at last, we found that 85 or 76% of all population are already received hepatitis B or C test. So the point is the person who found the positive, can they go to the clinic and treat it? Is a very good big question. So this is summary. And go to the next prevalence. So this is among first-time birth donors in 2011-2016 in whole Japan. Is every prefecture, you can see the Japan map. You know the Japan map? And the northern part is Hokkaido area, and the southern part is Kyushu area. So every area, you can see the high old age group is a little bit high, but to the young generation is very, very low. As for hepatitis B, is 0.05% in teenager, and as for the HCV, is almost the same. And, this is. Okay, the same graph is, that's okay. So this is a summary of the sentence. It's very, very low positivity in young generation, but a little bit higher in the old age group. But this is not age effect. This is only cohort effect. So in the future, the positivity in all population will be decreased. So the disease burden of hepatitis B see in Japan, our group, estimate and calculate and in the number of the people who are living with hepatitis B, hepatitis C divided by each group based on the government document and our epidemiological study or census or some others. So this is at the 2000, 3 million people are living with hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and then 2020 is half of them decreased. And remarkably, it is vanished, the graphs. So this is incorrect. So it is not so much. But in hepatitis C is only 0.4. As for hepatitis B, is 1 million, is 2020. It's a pity. So during this year, is as for hepatitis C, a cure because of the DAA is 0.5 or 0.8 million is already cured. So this is the number accurate. So, and it's so pity. I want to show you the total number of the patient on treatment on the clinic or hospital. So the trend of the number of the patient on treatment of on clinic is slightly increasing for hepatitis B. But you can see the number is decreasing. So as for hepatitis C, is the number of patients on treatment in the clinic is remarkably decreased. It means that they are cured and they don't need to on treatment at all. So I'm sorry. Now this is a summation of a prediction of the trend of hepatitis B, hepatitis C related liver cancer death by simulations. So it's a pity, I want to show this to you, but I'm sorry. So the decreasing for the liver cancer deaths caused by hepatitis C is remarkably decreasing in the future. So it's also the prediction of the trend of the people living with hepatitis B, hepatitis C also. So this is a small data from Japan, but I have a little time to show you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Juko. We're gonna have time for questions. Let's have a few now if anybody has any questions at this point. You've had large scale population testing policies for over 20 years.
Yeah.
Where were those policies most successfully put in place, and where is more work needed?
Since 2002.
Since 2002, or yeah. Really, like yeah. Right now.
Right now, it's still going.
Yeah, is it being done well in certain prefectures or like primary care versus prisons or different settings.
This is the national screening targeted in for over 40 years old. 40 years old is it's on the healthy people and not in the people in the prison or some others. So we have a mini chance to in the clinic testing in clinic or hospital, but for the prisons is the government. Maybe I think that I know that the government have a plan to test in prison, but they couldn't publish the data in the public, mm-hmm. in the result. But yeah.
See if there's any other questions. I'll have one more. Please introduce yourself.
Come on in from Myanmar.
Yeah.
Just not really a question. I would like to indicate a very strange phenomenon in my country for the HBsAg testing, because a lot of young people are going out of the country. Not only from the city, but also from the villages also. The job agencies are going even village by village and arranging for them to get a job, either Korea, Japan, Malaysia. These are the three countries where they don't accept, where HBsAg positive. So HBsAg positive, all of a sudden, during the last 3 years, has went up. Oh. This is one strange phenomenon I want to put my input. That will not be reflected in the government reports or WHO reports that we see this happening. Just input.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Any other comments? One last question quickly. One issue in the United States is the large percentage of people who are diagnosed but then do not get treated.
Yeah.
How big of a problem is that in Japan?
Yeah, this issue is the same problem in Japan in the past and getting better and better, because we have some special medical care person. So they if they found people who already tested and they found to be positive, they suggested to go to the clinic or some others, or they give a knowledge about diseases. It leads to the liver cancer or something, and there is some subsidy found from the government for the treatment. So they have some knowledge about the budget or some risk for liver cancer. So is the percentage of they don't linked care, not to linked care percentage, is getting better and better.
That's good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Wakita Tagachi, who's the from the Virus Division of Japan National Institute of Infectious Diseases. He is a longtime colleague, does a lot of work, particularly around hepatitis B in the region, and that's my pleasure to have him join the program today. Wakita.
Thank you, John, for your kind introduction, and thank you very much for the giving me this opportunity. My name is Takaji Wakita from National Institute of Infectious Diseases, Japan. Okay, today I'm going to talk about the HBV hepatitis research priority to guide policy development. And there is nothing to disclose. And first of all, I would like to acknowledge that this presentation is modified from the materials provided Ministry of Health and these scientists. Thank you very much. So the progress toward hepatitis elimination in Japan, the WHO set the goal to eliminate viral hepatitis as a major public health burden in by 2030, and I hope that Japan is one of the country on the track to the elimination. And the history of hepatitis measures in Japan, in 2006 and 2007, there was a hepatitis B and hepatitis C lawsuits. And the one is going to Supreme Court decision, and another one is there was a settlement And then after that, hepatitis virus infection became a big social problem. So the government set the comprehensive measures against hepatitis, and then they set law on the special measures against hepatitis C. And also 2010, they set basic law on the hepatitis measures. So the, since then, huge amount of budget is set, and the coming the fiscal year 2024 started from the this April, and the next year we have the 16.8 billion Japanese yen is approximately 111 million US dollar, including the this budget, including the promotion of liver disease treatment and hepatitis virus testing, and the strengthening of treatment of liver diseases and dissemination of correct knowledge to the public, and of course, promotion of research. For the research budget, it's 3.8 billion Japanese yen. And they set the basic role on hepatitis measures, and this including the promotion of prevention and early detection and promotion of equalization of hepatitis medical care, and promotion of research. And the hepatitis research promotion strategy is the hepatitis was established to address the need for the further promotion of research, and there were still some issues to be addressed. And they said the strategic goals for the hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and the non-compensated cirrhosis and liver cancer, like as indicator for the treatment outcome. So to achieve the, these goals, there are two kinds of research program in Japan. One is the research program on hepatitis by supported by funded by AMED. This program aims to significantly improve the treatment of hepatitis by comprehensively promoting basic and clinical research on hepatitis, and including two types: the program or for the basic and clinical research on hepatitis for the better clinical outcome, and another one is program on the innovative development of and application of new drugs for the hepatitis B, since the still we need more much better treatment for hepatitis B. And another type of research is the policy research project for viral hepatitis toward the viral hepatitis elimination. The basic guideline for promotion of control measures for hepatitis is to achieve complete elimination of viral hepatitis. Further promotion of measures for the three steps of screening, diagnosis, and treatment, and establish of a network among the specialized medical institutions, dissemination of correct information and awareness. And the promotion of hepatitis research will all help to achieve this goal. So there are sorry, this is Japanese, so I made translation, tentatively translation, for the policy research project group for viral hepatitis. There are nine research groups, including the Dr. Junko Tanaka, the her research group aimed the epidemiological research of the nationwide status of hepatitis virus infection. So I will skip this slide because Junko already mentioned of this. And the, this is correct figure. She skipped, but this is a cascade of hepatitis B. Or in 2000, there were 1.3 to 1.4 million carriers, but now it is decreasing and the ongoing treatment. And the, for the HCV carriers, much we have a tremendous success for the cure, and the total carrier is much less compared to 2000. And the second group is Dr. Eguchi's research group. He aimed to the research about the human resource development for the total care of liver diseases. This is very important for the cascade care because of the from the 2008 to 2012, they observed like this. After the, testing positive for the going to the further detailed examination, and the diagnosis and finally treated. But only 12% of cases positive for the HCV antibody lead to the antiviral treatment after testing positive. So this cascade, only 12% was treated. So we need to increase each cascade. So an active campaign is needed to introduce the treatment. So they target about the smooth and quick throughput of ecosystem from the screening to the treatment. So each step, there are a few stakeholders for the detailed examination and treatment and follow-up. This is this ecosystem, smooth and quick throughput is very important. So to do so, the research is a development of human resources that contribute to total care of liver diseases that can respond to various pathology and improvement of the quality of the activities. So they named hepatitis care or medical coordinators. So they can support the patient. They can go undergo appropriate detailed examination, treatment, and follow-up actions. And a hepatitis care coordinator or hepatitis medical coordinator is a various part. They coordinate by using their strengths, coordinate the appropriate promotion of hepatitis. So public nurses and association of patients and local government officials, workplace, a nurse, physician, dentist, clinical technology, pharmacist. So disseminate the understanding of hepatitis, provide advice and information on consultation services, encourage people to take examination, and explain the support system for hepatitis patient subsidies. So the elimination, eliminate the prejudice and discrimination against hepatitis patient, etc. So they all support from the cascade or ecosystem. So next research group is by Dr. Korenaga. They aim a research to improve hepatitis virus that participant rate and lead smooth consultation. So there are still many people who did not undergo viral hepatitis screening tests at the Japanese work site. So their data indicated the blue collar workers in the blue collar industry showed a high risk of viral hepatitis infection. So in their research, they modified client reminders using nudge theory that were significantly increased the hepatitis screening uptake at lower cost per person. Their leaflet were used to at the middle small size company in 10 prefectures. There was a significant difference in hepatitis screening attendance rate. The positive rate of HCV antibody in the 50s were higher than those aged in the 60s. And four males in the 60s were detected hepatocellular carcinoma. Therefore, promoting hepatitis virus screening for workers at general checkup can rescue hepatitis virus carriers who are unaware of their infected and require the therapy of virus elimination and liver cancers. So the Dr. Yazuhashi's research group aimed for the desirable consideration for human rights discrimination and prejudice for hepatitis carriers. So research aimed, this is the title, and they screened, they have questionnaires, and have you ever experienced unpleasant feelings such as discrimination or prejudice because you are infected hepatitis B and C? And frequency is answered yes. But compared to hepatitis B, hepatitis C carriers, answer yes was lower. The HCV patient had significantly lower frequency of discrimination, and this is thought to be due to the effect of virus elimination by DA treatment. And this is the same trend. And the last one by Dr. Kanto, he promoted equalization of hepatitis countermeasures according to local circumstances using indicators. So they developed several indicators to assess of the performance of hepatitis countermeasures and hepatitis medical care, and they assessed the performance. And the change of usage rate of subsidies or antiviral treatment in Japan For HBV, nucleus analog treatment is same, but the DAA treatment for HCV is decreasing. And change for staffing rate of health medical care coordinators in various institutes, regional core hospitals, various hospitals, public health centers, municipal governments, they are improving trend. So this is a summary and global health sector strategy on viral hepatitis sets, a goal to eliminate viral hepatitis as a major public health threat by 2030. So Japanese government set the basic rule on hepatitis measures, including promotion of prevention and early detection of hepatitis medical care and research. Hepatitis research promotion strategy was established to address further promotion of research activity to achieve elimination of hepatitis, viral hepatitis. And I hope Japan is on the track to eliminate hepatitis. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Any questions or comments for Wakita? Please.
Again, come on, from memory. In your, as you have described, from the testing, the linkage of care is very low, around 30%. To cure that problem, you have proposed increasing the human resource of the medical coordinators.
Yes.
At the same time, I would like to point out that equally important to the increasing the human responses, the simplification of the treatment regime, less and less possible hospital visits, and making the person to be amenable to the therapy, and very simplified, like APASL, very simplified treatment is also equally important as increasing the human resource. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your comment. And I think the Japanese people rather very much would like to visit hospitals. So, but so that is a very important point. Thank you very much. Please.
Hey, Bob.
Hi, morning. It's Robert Gish, Hepatitis B Foundation. Very nice presentation. I wanted to know in Japan about stigma. It's parallels with discrimination, but there's societal stigma and self-stigma. Have you measured this? And if so, what's your data?
Yeah. I am not directly measure the stigma or but the discrimination. But there is a research group about the estimation of the stigma and the other such kind of things. Yeah, but I'm not directly know about that.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think the other lesson from Japan that I take is that you have to be persistent. When you come to hepatitis elimination, you've had policies in place for quite some time, and you have to continue to seek ways of implementing those policies as you move along.
Yeah, yes, actually. We have the office for the in the ministry for the about the hepatitis elimination. Yeah.
Right, and we'll be hearing I think from that, from the Japanese government tomorrow as a demonstrating their commitment to hepatitis elimination. Thanks again, Wakita. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Now, my pleasure to move to Professor Jia Jidong. He is the director of the Liver Research Center at the Beijing Friendship Hospital, Capital University in Beijing, China. As the media past president of the Chinese Society of Hepatology and is also past president of APASL. And it's our pleasure to welcome him to the program today.
So my time is 10 minutes or so. I see. Hello, good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Zhang to invite me to this very important session, this pre-meeting of the APASL. So my task today is just talk about a little bit about the new treatment guideline in China and the progress of HCV prevention in China. This is the my disclosure. Well, just this slide showing the achievement. This review paper just published in Clinical and Molecular Hepatology, published in Korea. We can see as an increase of the HBV vaccination, then the prevalence of HBV surface antigen decrease in general population, and especially in the young age group, less than age five. But here, please be noted that these 2 points, this is not the national survey data because the last one has not published. Here, I just use a polarized the modeling. So I use the dashed line. But I hope very close, this kind of estimation, very close to the real data, but has not published. I cannot sign here. Well, for this slide, perhaps you're very familiar with, for the cost of treatment decreased dramatically in the last 10 years for because the generic medication has become very, very cheap. So the affordability have improved dramatically. So this is study by our own group showing that after the national so-called centralized negotiation and approved procurement, you can see the total amount of medication increased dramatically. At the same time, the cost decreased dramatically. That means we spend less money to treat more patients. So that's what we expect. So however, that's a big problem. The diagnosis rate for Hep B and the treatment rate is very low compared with the target. Although we have done a great job in the prevention. All these are very good for the timely burst dose and the 3-dose coverage of Hep B in all infants. So again, this is, you can see that's last 2 years ago, the data 2 years ago. So that's the treatment rate. Actually, this is calculated those who are eligible for treatment is increased, but overall it's still very, very low. So to cope this problem, the Chinese new guideline updated actually last year, they published last year. You can see the most important thing is expanding testing and treatment. So we recommend in addition to high risk groups or at risk groups, we recommend the routine check in the health checkup. Of course, outside of the settings for recruitment, for schools, for employment, because that will cause big problem for the discrimination. Otherwise, we encourage the test of HBV markers in all health check meeting, health check settings. Then another very important update for the guideline is we expanding the treatment. Traditionally, we just treat those with chronic hepatitis, E-positive chronic hepatitis B and inactive chronic hepatitis B, we call it active disease. But now actually, we realize there's a gray zone between these stages. So we also recommend treatment for this gray zone. That's the very important thing. So actually, we also adopt a very more stringent facing criteria. Therefore, though the gray zone area become less compared with previously, then we have much more stringent. We can see for inactive carrier, we need to have a negative HBV DNA. That means lower than the low limit of quantification instead of 1,000 or something like that. So by adopting more stringent criteria, actually we reduced you can see that's a gray zone area, that's the ASLD gray zone area. The gray zone area decreased. So that means with more patients can be treated. So now we almost treat all patients with detectable HBV DNA. Because we even those with so-called immune tolerance phase or inactive phase, we still found a significant proportion of patients have neck inflammation or fibrosis in their liver tissues. So that's the major thing. Then for this is the very good summary by the polar risk group, by our guideline. You can see we treat all patients with detectable HBV DNA if they are older than 30 years. So this already, just any detectable actually is quantifiable HBV DNA. Even for those with less than 30 years old, if they have detectable HBV DNA, we treat. If they have higher ALT than one times upper limit or normal, or histology, or non-invasive fibrosis or necroinflammation, or have family history of cirrhosis or SCC, or have actual hepatic manifestations. So you can see actually in China now, we have 90% of patients are actually older than 30 years old. That means for this age group, if you can treat if they have detectable HBV DNA. For less than around 10% of patients younger than 30 years old, they can also be treated if they have any of this. So overall, the treatment indication become very, very broad. Actually, this is a recent publication. They compare the different guidelines. Almost you can see China guideline, just a small proportion of patients didn't treat. So this is a very close to treat all policy. So hopefully this also shed some light on the update of other guidelines. So that's the progress of the update for hepatitis B guideline. For hepatitis C, that's the current diagnosis rate and the treatment rate. Treatment rate is very low, although we also have very good policy on the massive reduction in the pricing. So that's the things I would like to show you in this. You can see the price of the DAAs decreased by 70 or even 80%. So now this is a big improvement in China. We can see that's the continuous effort of eliminating hepatitis C in China. Now we have, by 2020, we have a national action plan. So this is very important. The national action plan require the testing and the treating hepatitis C. They have a detailed requirement. So that's very important. Also have a pilot programs. Now, very important, we have a web-based national hepatitis C control and prevention information system. This, we have a reporting system before, but very detailed data. Since 2 years ago, we have this very detailed information system. So we also have action plan here. They require the treatment and testing and treatment. This you can see that by the government, several multi departments of the government issued this. This is an explanation of this action plan. Well, they just key point, by 2 years ago, then you can see the all this harm reduction reached almost near to 100%. By next year, I would say, testing, HCV RNA testing need to be 90% among those who are positive for antibody. Then gradually, treatment need to be 80%, cure rate need to be 95%. By 2030, HCV testing for newly reported HCV positive individuals expected to exceed 95%, and the treatment rate need to reach the 80%. So this is a very important progression. Another thing is that in China, HCV were taken care of by a group, HIV, HCV, and other STD diseases. But HBV were taken care of by just the program immunization. But now they integrated, finally, just one center. I mean, both HBV and HCV take care of by the Center for for Hepatitis, for HIV centers. So they have take care of all the, not only prevention, but also treatment. So I think this is a very important shift to emphasize to the importance of this treatment. All right, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Jidong. Questions, comments, please? It's Yeah. A lot of new policies for China. Please come to the microphone if you can.
If you can. In the middle.
Did you? If you want to have a.
Dr. Easterbrook.
Comment.
Thanks very much. I notice I'm wearing exactly the same outfit as in the photo. Yeah, I obviously need to refresh my wardrobe a little bit.
I have the same tie on, if that makes you feel any better. Too.
Thank you. I just had a question about the HBDNA assay and the limit of quantification, because I think I heard you remark that the quantification may be down to 1,000, but could you just elaborate on that? When you say detectable, what assays and what limit of detection are you citing?
That's a very important question. That's actually in China, we use two versions, generally two versions or even more versions of DNA assay. One is Roche or the Abbott. The have very low limit of detection, about not detection, no quantification, I would say 10 IU or 20 IU. In some the generic version also we have around 50 IU or some even 200 or 100. So generally we gradually use more and more sensitive assay. So that's the low limit of quantification. For the definition of inactive carrier, we use a very stringent. Whatever test, they have below the low limit of detection. Before it is higher than lower than 1,000, we already quantify or already fulfill the definition of inactive carrier. But now it's much lower limit. Lower limit.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Bob.
Best comment, just want to compliment you and your team on this guideline. It really becomes the engine, not the caboose. This is on behalf of the Hepatitis B Foundation. And we have a letter coming out from our foundation, hopefully very soon, will support something very close
Thank
to
you.
This.
Thank you very much.
I'm Brian Conway from Vancouver in Canada. For the purposes of this meeting, consider it Far Eastern Asia, okay? could you go back to your Hep C slide? There's some wording I want to ask you about. And, you know, some of you might know that Vancouver, you know, 35% of the population is Asian. And it's a real melting pot. And we have, no, I'm sorry, it was the text where you have the word PWID in it. Sorry.
PWID?
PWID, where you have PWID.
Where?
Oop. It's towards the end when you have your global objectives.
Hep C.
Sorry, if I said Hep B, I misspoke.
Yeah.
So, no, keep going. That's good. Oh. It's towards the end.
Yeah, this one. Maybe
there
this.
We go. Where you talk about the eligible and intervention measures for PWID covered. More than 80%. So in across Asia, you know, if you look at, you know, South Korea, Taiwan, everyone has a different view of this population in terms of how they're integrated into society. And we all agree we have to treat them all to eliminate hepatitis C. And we're not going to change everybody's point of view. I don't expect decriminalization of heroin to, you know, take place everywhere. In fact, it may not even be working in Vancouver. So when you talk about more than 80% of the population, do you have an idea what's the target population of PWID in China and how you identify them and how they're excluded or included? I realize it's a very broad question, but it strikes at the key of what we're trying to do in PWID across the world and in the Pacific region, in which I include Vancouver.
Wow, this is a very important question, but unfortunately I'm a clinician, but I know in China we have a special program conducted by the CDC, China CDC. They have a special team. Well, one on, as I mentioned, this take care by institute by hepatitis C, HIV, and all these diseases. They have their kind of network to take care of all these patients. Because in general, for in the general hospital visiting and other clinical setting, we rarely see these kind of patients.
Okay.
Perhaps that's the story. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think that that's off the top at Thank the moment. You. Thank you. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jacob George. He is the Robert Storr Professor of Hepatic Medicine at the Storr Liver Center, Westmead Institute for Medical Research, University of Sydney. He's also the chair of, for research for APASL, and he's also a member of the APASL Viral Hepatitis Elimination Task Force. Welcome.
Okay, thank you very much, John, and to the organizers for inviting me to speak today. And as many of you may know, Australia has really been one of the, at the vanguard of hepatitis C elimination efforts. And I want to just give you some idea of Australia's progress towards hepatitis C elimination, and also how we've been trying to ensure equity in elimination. This audience does not need any introduction, but the aim for hepatitis C by 2030 is to go from numbers and percentages to actual rates, to reduce the incidence rates to less than 5% in hepatitis C, and among PWIDs to reduce it to 2 or less per 100,000 or 2%, and to reduce the annual mortality to less than 2 per 100,000. So one of the interesting things and one of the benefits in Australia is that we've had a very, very useful and utilitarian development of our DAA program. So we've only got one purchaser that buys all hepatitis C or hepatitis B drugs, that's the Australian government, and we've got unrestricted DAA access. So from the government's perspective, everyone's covered under national insurance, therefore there's no cap on treatment numbers. Everyone, whether they're insured or privately insured or not, can get treatment. But the government sets a cap on expenditure, and they have a negotiation with pharma. And so the pharma agreement might be, we're going to spend $200 million a year or $500 million a year, whether you treat one patient or 50,000 patients, the government has an accepted cost limit of $500 million or whatever it is. And so for us in 2016 to 2020, the cost per patient per course was as low as about 6,000 euro. We've had a long history of non-specialists being involved in DAA prescribing, and there's very minimal administration for clinicians. So we just use an ordinary script. You write the script, anyone can write the script, the patient goes and gets the script fulfilled for the treatment. And there's no co-payment for pharmacists in our state in New South Wales. You get the script. Normally, pharmacy will charge you $15 or $20. In New South Wales, it's $0. You give the script, you get the money. But this, what we have today, is actually the consequences of development over the last 25 years. So we've had a national hepatitis C strategy since 2000. We've had bipartisan political support. We've had partnership with government, community, clinical, and academic representatives. The government's also funded drug user and community organizations and stakeholders such as Hepatitis C Australia to actually continue the awareness raising work. And we've had a long history of engagement with GPs and addiction medicine clinicians since the early 2000s. And harm reduction has been really part and parcel of the hepatitis C healthcare system for PWID since the 1990s and the HIV epidemic. So the model that's actually been used, and it's really a flagship, is diversity and flexibility. So we end up having, and I think all of this audience will know, you need different and flexible approaches in drug and alcohol clinics, in primary care centers. That'll be different from what's happening in tertiary care, different to what's happening in prisons or community health centers. And in Australia, we're such a big country, we need to have a different model for use in remote and regional locations. So our 2018 to 2022 targets really suggested that we need to increase the proportion of people who have hepatitis C to over 90%, and we've already achieved this, and we wanted to reduce the mortality by 65%. This is data from the Kirby Institute, where Professor Greg Dorr works, and it's a national surveillance institute. You can see in the black, in the interferon treatment era, we were only treating about 3,000 to 4,000 patients. The red here is the DAA treatments, which started in 2014-15 through clinical trials. And then March 2016 was a sentinel year for us, where DAAs were approved by the government and we were treating up to 32,000. The numbers have come down as we've treated more and more of our patients. But as you will see, that even today in 2022, which is where the latest data is exceeds the number that we had for interferon-based treatments. One of the interesting trends, because we've got all this national data, is looking at initial treatments and retreatments. You can see early on, most of the treatments were for newly diagnosed hepatitis C. And you can see that by the time we get to 2022, and I'll show you a slide a bit later, but in 2023, one third, 32% of our patients being treated are retreatments for their hepatitis C. We've got a diverse range of prescribers, which has been absolutely critical. You can see in the purple are the specialists, and that's just not gastroenterologists. It's probably about 60% gastroenterologists, but it involves drug and addiction specialists, primary care, specialist physicians and other groups. This is the, in the blue is the general practitioners, and you can see more than 50% of prescribers are general practitioners. And we've really emphasized nurse practitioners to be able to educate, treat, and write prescriptions to treat patients. So we've got a diverse range of prescribers. So what have we actually achieved? And this is really looking at some of the data that we have. This is looking at treatment in prisons. And in prisons, we've used a nurse-led model of care with education and training. Instead of specialists having to see the patients, we have skilled nurses doing it. So the model is very decentralized. Some of them have face-to-face, some of them have telemedicine, and everything is protocol and performer driven so that it actually minimizes the risk of errors. And then there's been continuous research evaluation. And as you will see here, prison-based treatment initiations in 2016 were only 6%, compared to the community, whereas in 2020, 37% of treatment initiations were in the prison settings and 67% in the community settings. We've done microelimination in mental health settings, and this is in the mental health setting in our local health district. So about in this particular paper, 322 inpatients, everyone was tested, and we had a opt-out consent form for this with ethics approval. The prevalence rate was 7.5% compared to our prevalence, which is about 0.5%, and about half of them underwent treatment, and everyone who got tested was PCR negative. We also have community mental health clozapine clinics where our liver nurses or mental health nurses actually give patients a form and they can go and get themselves tested. Our nurses are much more successful. Hepatology nurses are more successful in getting patients to have a blood test compared to community mental health settings. And I think this is because of competing priorities. But again, you see that the prevalence rate is high and we have been able to treat the patients, and all the patients that have come back for testing are PCR negative. This is data from the Australian Needle and Syringe Exchange Program. And you will see compared to 2010-2015, where the incidence per 100 person years was 13.6, it has decreased to 5.4, 58% reduction in HCV incidence. Again, this is another slide from our needle and syringe exchange programs. And the number that had ever had treatment increased from about 11% back in the early 2000s to about 67% now. And the numbers that are hepatitis C PCR positive has actually come down from 53% to 12%, suggesting that we're making real inroads into this high-risk population. Again, this is looking at primary care, general practice, and this is looking at some sentinel sites with over about 2,000 patients. And you will see the incidence per 100 person years has declined from about 1.5 down to about 0.7, 0.8. So the number of incident infections in primary care has declined from 25 to 3 in 2020, suggesting again that in different settings, we are making progress. So does that actually translate to changes in notifications? This is the high-risk group, 15 to 24. And as you will see, there is a, this is looking at fitter trend and overall trend. There's a reduction in hepatitis C notifications nationally. And then this is just highlighting the data of all treatments that are given in Australia, because they're all linked to the government notification index. You can see the numbers that are having treatment have decreased over time. The number of retreatments have increased, such that by the first half of 2023, one in three patients of all treatment initiations were actually retreatments of individuals. And really, there's no discrimination. We can give it as many times as we want. And the whole idea is to eliminate hepatitis C from injecting networks. This is data from the most populous state, New South Wales, which has got 10 million of the 27 million people in Australia. And this is looking at absolute numbers, and this is looking at age standardized rates. So decompensated cirrhosis, the vertical line is when we had DAAs from the government. You can see decompensated cirrhosis has decreased, age standardized decompensations have decreased, liver-related mortality has decreased, and HCC age standardized incidence has decreased, and the absolute numbers have stabilized. So we're actually seeing micro level trends that are being translated into national level trends. And finally, just to finish off, looking at some modeling of where we are going. So up till 2021, these are actual numbers that were treated based on our notifiable disease index and our treatments. So the 6,474 is identical. And then we assumed that post-2022, a pessimistic scenario, an intermediate scenario, an optimistic scenario. So in the optimistic scenario, we'd be treating 8,228 patients. And in the pessimistic scenario, it'd be about 40% less. And if we actually model that going towards 2030, you will see that the number of people living with hep C, its incidence, treatment coverage, and liver-related deaths, according to all scenarios, are likely to significantly reduce. And so in terms of our model progress by 2030, we should be getting to a HCV incidence. You know, the WHO talked about 5% or less, 5 per 100,000 or less, we're getting down to 3.8. And liver-related deaths in terms of getting less than 2 per 100,000, we should be at 2 by 2030. So what are the strategies that we're trying to go on to remove the last remaining pockets with hepatitis C? It's really monitoring for reinfection at individual and population level and early treatment. In all our high-risk settings, we are suggesting that everyone has PCR testing about once a year. Rollout of point-of-care tests, and it's actually being headed by Jason Grebley, a Canadian. Continued care from East Asia, as the previous person mentioned. Continued linkage to care in high-risk population settings. Primary care routine pathology testing and dedicated funding for monitoring progress. So this is our point of care strategy. High prevalence settings, it's HCV PCR RNA, HCV RNA, and in low risk settings, homeless centers, etc., we're doing antibody testing, and if positive, we're going to PCR testing. So this is Professor Grebley's national point of care study, 90 sites nationally, already expecting to test about 60,000 patients. And it's been a huge undertaking by Jason to organize the logistics, training, and the quality assurance. So I just want to complete it there. A lot of the data is generated by Professor Greg Dorr on the national epidemiological trends. And Jason Grebley is really heading the point of care testing. And thanks to both of them for sharing the slides. Very happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Great, it seems like
I don't mean to hog the microphone, but I knew Jason Grebley before he was Jason Grebley. He got his PhD with me at the University of British Columbia. Glad to share him.
Great export, I think.
Yeah, but, and it sounds like in Australia, once a Canadian, always a Canadian. So that's good.
That was a great talk. Thank you very much. So you started off with a relatively low prevalence compared to the world. Yeah. How did you manage to convince the government that this was an important thing to get into compared to many other diseases that Australia might have, cardiovascular, oncology, et cetera, et cetera? That is the big difficulty that many, many countries face in order to prioritization.
I think this started in Australia in the 1980s. HIV was such a big thing back in the mid-1980s that this idea of having a unified approach to control that infectious disease started. And then, you know, by 1990, the new kid on the block was an antibody test for hepatitis C, and that momentum continued. And everyone actually understood that what works for one infectious disease might work for everyone, and it actually will reduce healthcare costs.
Who pushed this? Was it the academia? Was it the communities? Who pushed this for the government?
So with HIV, a lot of it had to do with the affected communities, but government very quickly came on board. And then we had key academic stakeholders that were really able to impact this.
I think it takes multiple voices, not just one.
Yeah, and it's 25 years we've taken to get to here.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay, Kim Wing from Myanmar. Your Japanese colleagues, as well as in your presentation, I do not find the impact of COVID epidemic on the hepatitis B and C control programs in my country severely affected. Did you notice any effect by the COVID?
We had a slight dip, but we had, you know, telemedicine right through COVID, which was funded by the government. There were some impact, but not a huge impact. So all the graphs, you can actually see a little bit of a dip in terms of the notifications, but in terms of treatments, there wasn't that huge a change, and it rapidly picked up straight after COVID.
Thank you. Philippa.
Thanks. I just wanted to give you some good news, because since the elimination guidance was first published in 2021, we updated this at WHO, and so the new mortality target is actually a combined mortality absolute target of less than 6 per 100,000. So that makes life a lot easier. And the other new dimension of the elimination guidance was a path to elimination. We'd already included it for the path to elimination for mother to child transmission for hepatitis B, but this now also includes the hep C and hep B as a public health threat. And you only need to meet the programmatic coverage targets. You don't need the incidence or mortality. So we're hoping that this will encourage many more countries to submit for the path to elimination as a sort of a goalpost on the way to full elimination. Thank you.
Great.
Well, speaking of that, you've made remarkable progress. I mean, truly, Australia is out in front in many, many areas. And really, the combination of reducing incidence among people who inject drugs, coupled with the decreased viremia, decreasing in case reporting, is all reflecting of your really good program. You have to continue to be persistent. But as Philippa just pointed out, the current goal is elimination as a public health threat, which is a pretty soft goal, actually. And I just wondered if you feel like Australia has the political will to really move forward to true elimination goals for hepatitis-related mortality or incidence. Do you think that's possible in Australia?
Yes, I think there is a political will. And as I said, it's historical. And now every state in the country, and there's a national hepatitis C patient stakeholder group. So they're all banging on the government. And we've actually noticed significant reductions as I've shown you. I mean, this is a van that we've got in our hospital. In my hospital, in the tertiary clinics, I don't see hepatitis C anymore. It's full of MAFLD because all the patients that used to come to hospitals, they've just gone. And all the patients are now in the community, and we're just trying to have models that work for the community.
Excellent. Thank you. Really appreciate that, Jacob. Thank you so much. So it's about 25 after. Let's take about a 10-minute break. Everybody can relax for a moment, and let's try to come back a little bit around 35 after the hour, and we'll hear from the rest of our program. And thank you very much for a robust discussion to this point. Thank you, and thanks again to our speakers. Let's go ahead and get started for the second part of our program. To help us reconvene, we will show a video. Introduce this video. Where is it from?
Okay. Hello, everybody. This is a short video from the LEAP project, which is a micro-elimination project in Rawalpindi, Pakistan, from one of the coalition's heroes, fellows, Nita Ali, who produced this.
पैंतालीस साल है तो मैं होस वाइफ हूँ दो साल पहले मेरे जेठ की डेथ हुई थी हेपेटाइटिस से फिर डॉक्टरों ने बताया कि इनका लीवर ख़त्म हो गया है एक टीम हमारे घर में लीप की टीम आई उन्होंने हमारे टेस्ट किए हेपेटाइटिस के फिर मुझे पता लगा कि मुझे हेपेटाइटिस सी है मैं और मेरे हस्बैंड बहुत परेशान हुए क्योंकि इस बीमारी से पहले हमारे घर में एक डेथ हो गई थी और इसके जो दवाइयाँ और टेस्ट नज़दीक महंगे थे हम नहीं करा सकते थे लीप की टीम ने मेरे वो टेस्ट भी फ्री में किए और मेडिसिन भी मुझे फ्री में दिए हैं दवाइयाँ खाने से बाद मैंने मुझे जिस्म में अभी कोई तकलीफ नहीं है कोई दर्द नहीं है और मुझे नींद भी सही आती है कि मैं शुक्रगुजार हूँ कि मेरे उन्होंने मेडिसिन सारा कुछ मुझे फ्री दिया है
Thank you. That's the kind of impact we're seeking to have around the world. It's my pleasure to have George Lau joining us. that's right. So just by walking in the room, you get a round of applause. You should feel good about that.
Yeah, thanks. Applause to you too. Welcome, John.
That's good. Go ahead. Any comments before we get started?
Yeah, well, I'm so glad that So it's not the noise. It's not the microphone. Wonderful. First of all, I want to congratulate the effort by John. And in fact, some times ago, actually many years ago, we have always tried to think about how we are going to deal with this viral hepatitis worldwide, especially in Asia Pacific regions. We have discussions in Hawaii meeting in the HAPDOT, and we have connections And sadly, when we look at the figures since the WHO has announced its 2030 vision statements, and it takes some years, we are not seeing the impact. And we have some discussions of why that happens, why our patients are still suffering from and dying from liver cancer related to viral hepatitis, especially hepatitis B and some of them hepatitis C. So we really want to get an opportunity to get people like you. You are all very good people because you come to the meeting rather than the touring around to have a heart and to how are we going to bring the science back to our patients and we can benefit them. And I think this is the whole idea about the call for actions. Now it is time to eliminate hepatitis in Asia. We have gathered a group of people on behalf of APASL, our task force, people like Professor Jia Jidong here representing China, Professor Shamit from Pakistan, Maria from Malaysia, and we formed the APASL Viral Elimination Task Force. So I'm supposed to talk about this. The PowerPoint is not moving. Okay. Okay. All right.
And then just.
All right. Roll the first. Okay.
Okay. Sure. Thanks.
I'm not wearing a tie because I was just landed in Osaka, and it takes 3.5 hours to get here. I just rush in, and then I was noticed that I need to give another talk at another room, so I my apologies for not being here full time. Now, I think that's that this figures shows the global prevalence of liver diseases in terms of hepatitis B, hepatitis C, alcohol-related liver diseases, and metabolic dysfunction-associated fatty liver diseases. And you can see the red color, where the fire is. The fire is in Asia-Pacific regions, not just the China's, Pakistan, India's, and we peoples in Asia-Pacific regions are really suffering from liver diseases related especially to viral hepatitis. And then the metabolic dysfunction associated fatty liver disease also coming into a picture. We have more obesity, fatty livers, and this actually increases the problems of the existing viral hepatitis patients. We have tons of cases with both diseases, the MAFRS and also viral hepatitis. Now we, and some of them also start to drink a lot, like our Indian colleagues and China colleagues. And so it's a complexity. We cannot isolate one from each other. And I think, but viral eliminations would be a great help. But the prevalence of liver disease is not just viral hepatitis. It's sometimes it's multiple nowadays. Now, talking about from a perspective from a practicing hepatologist like myself for the past 30 years in Asia-Pacific regions, it's really a dismay to see people still comes in with hepatocellular carcinomas, late stage, usually beyond curative therapy, end-stage liver cirrhosis, acute and chronic liver failure. As I mentioned, the four main driver to get this happens to our poor patients is chronic hepatitis B, chronic hepatitis C, MAFRS, and alcoholic liver diseases. Now, I just mentioned about this WHO Global Hepatitis Eliminations targets for 2030, and this is something I think this task force is going to work on and to see whether we can be more realistic and how we're going to change our gear to materialize our efforts. It's actually a 65% reduction, so that's what the vision is. By 2030, with a 10% reduction by 2020, which is not happening because this is already 2024. The surface antigen reductions, 30%, yes, 90% reductions further and in 2030. We are seeing reductions of the surface antigens because of the universal vaccinations and also the application of the mucosa to the high viral load maternal side. So where we are now, it's really dismay. So there's a recent papers published in the Lancet Gastroenterology and Hepatology, the Polaris Observatory Collaborative collaborators. We can see clearly here the mortality due to liver cancer and decompensated liver cirrhosis, which is mainly driven by the viral hepatitis B and some of the hepatitis C, is actually increasing rather than decreasing. So we really need to know how we are going to change this momentum. I suppose what we are doing is in the opposite directions. The surface antigen is coming down, but we have others comers which complicate the matters like the MAFRS and also alcoholic liver diseases, but the hepatitis B is not coming down substantially as to what we want. So I think that's the reason why we try to get this thinking big, hepatitis B and C eliminations in Asia, and how we are going to bring up policy or ideas from the group to bridge the gap between science and the patients, which we have the science. We have all the antivirals, hepatitis C, we have Panorus DAAs, and also not just effective, but safe. And also the cost has drastically reduced with the wide availability of the generics. For hepatitis B, we have all the medications registered from 1998 to 2016, starting from lamivudine, not used anymore, but pegylated interferon alpha to a nukes high resistant barriers, especially those very useful compounds like entecavir, tenofovir, and TOF. And we also have very effective screening assay, universal quick test, surface antigen positive. Positivity can be easily done. The test is very reliable with high sensitivity and specificity. So, in addition, we also have low cost and effective surveillance measures like alpha fetoprotein or ultrasound, and just cannot see a reason why this piece of science, which we have built up with all the guidelines and so on, is not bringing benefits to our patients. We are going in the wrong directions, or what is happening? So we really need a body of intelligence, people like you, and with a heart to serve our patients with liver diseases, to see how we are going to have a good solutions and how we are going to strategize our efforts to bring down the problems related to chronic hepatitis B and C. This is our APASL viral elimination task force. It is a very inclusive group, and we have all the friends and peoples from the over 26 countries or special administrative regions in the Asia Pacific regions. They have long-standing track records in working in viral hepatitis B, and lots of them are very respected figures, like Professor Zhang Hui from Beijing, and Professor Jar, and Serene himself, and also Professor Mata, and all the young and new peoples. And you are all welcome to join the APASL Viral Elimination Task Force, so that the Asia Pacific regions will be talking to people like John, and also to other society like ESO and ASLD, because I think one of the essence is different regions have different culture, different problems, which is not foreseeable and not understood by others. So we need to have a single voice to bring up the issues to others, and so that we can have a global effort to deal with this global threat, which is hurting our patients, especially in Asia Pacific regions. And that's all I want to talk about. And we are really thrilled. And I would like to say, on behalf of our APASL Viral Elimination Task Force, to this call to actions, and it's time to eliminate hepatitis in Asia. Thank you very much.
Thank you, George.
Let's turn to Dr. Philippa Easterbrook now. To Philippa is a senior scientist in the Global Hepatitis Program at WHO headquarters in Geneva. She's responsible for developing normative guidance for HIV as well as hepatitis B in the past, as well as hepatitis B and hepatitis C testing and treatment currently. We greatly appreciate Philippa joining our program today and being a longtime colleague. Philippa, welcome.
Thank you. So I'm going to be fairly brief, and I'm going to mainly focus on hepatitis B, but the purpose of my short presentation is to touch on the issue of research priorities and the process we went through as part of the Hep B guidelines in flushing out those critical research priorities. And at WHO, this is one of our core functions, to have a very transparent and credible process for establishing research priorities. And this can be in the area of a particular disease, or it can be a particular technology, and may happen at a national level, regional level, or global research priority setting. And a few years ago, a task force was established at WHO to look at our processes for research priority setting. And a survey was done, I think 115 documents and 2,000 research priorities, and really scrutinizing the processes. And what emerged, and I was part of the task force that developed this document of really establishing a more systematic approach to priority setting, was that there was a range of different approaches that were being used, that the methodology for research priority setting was rarely reported, and there was no actual follow-up. So a key message from this was the importance of having that very systematic approach, the planning, the implementing, the publishing, and then the evaluating. And then you can see the pie chart on the right was really looking at what were the areas of research priorities that WHO was looking at. And the implementation accounted for almost half of all those. So there are a range of different methodologies out there for that systematic, comprehensive approach to research priority setting. And these can operate at a national level or indeed regional level. And they all have their relative sort of pros and cons. But in addition, and this is really what I'm going to talk about, is the use of the guidelines process to identify those research gaps and priorities. And this is just a reminder of really the distinctive features of a WHO guidelines process. But for the purpose of the research priority setting, it's relevant in that our focus is particularly on low and middle income countries across a range of epidemic profiles, and very much the public health approach. And so that's the lens through which we also view the research priorities. And the big advantage is that the guidelines process, where we go through this very systematic approach to the evidence retrieval, looking at issues of programmatic feasibility, acceptability, the resource implications, provides that context. And we have a large number of people in the room or virtually, including program managers and civil society. So you will be hearing on Saturday when we launch the new 2024 Hep B guidelines of what exactly we're recommending. But just to give you a sense of the new directions and topics covered, that the who to treat, inevitably the expansion in the eligibility, treatment eligibility, the inclusion for the first time of adolescents, looking at the first line treatment now to include dual therapy, given that monotherapy is often unavailable, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. And then very importantly, expanding the eligibility criteria for the use of antivirals to prevent mother-to-child transmission to all Hep B surface antigen-positive pregnant women where you cannot get access to Hep B DNA, simplifying the diagnostics, the use of point-of-care viral load, reflex viral load testing, and for the first time looking at Delta testing, and then the simplification of service delivery. So this is to give you some sense. And this is the shift in the algorithm, the one on the left being in 2015, where the shaded box on the left was the who to treat and the rest of it was really largely monitoring. And the shift now with the new algorithm, where there's now a very, very small proportion who would not meet the eligibility criteria. And so going from being about 15% eligible up to more than 50, 60% of all those Hep B surface antigen positive. So there'll be the full guidelines
the policy brief plus the web annexes. So the process we went through, this is just to give you a snapshot because this is relevant to the research priorities, is a large number of systematic reviews that were formally commissioned. You see there on the left those different topics, also modeling work from CDA and the Institut Pasteur, the essential landscaping, market landscaping for the diagnostics in particular, as well as TAF and dual therapy led by the Clinton Health, and then the surveys for the acceptability to the affected community, patients, healthcare workers, Ministry of Health, hepatitis lead. So it's that 360 degree perspective. And so this is a very strong foundation to really then inform the research priorities. What are the gaps? We have this data. What was missing in terms of the process? So this is just a schematic that covers all the main chapters in the guidelines, and where, as part of these guideline chapters, the recommendations, the evidence base, the rationale, the implementation considerations, and then it finishes with the research gaps. So every chapter covered here has comprehensive research gaps as well. What I'm going to do now is just highlight four of these areas: the who to treat, the use of antiviral prophylaxis for the prevention of mother-to-child transmission, the treatment of adolescents, and on the simplified service delivery. So just to give you a sense and some headline messages. So on the who to treat, really the importance of establishing good long-term follow-up studies to assess the overall impact and the effectiveness of expanding the treatment eligibility, both for the main outcomes, morbidity, mortality, but importantly also looking at transmission and quality of life, as well as the harms and the cost implications. And particularly in low and middle income countries, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, or until recently, there was a real paucity of data, and in the under-researched populations. And particularly in Africa, where still there's a significant proportion of those less than 20 years who are Hep B surface antigen positive, the need for more data on this. I think always a surprise to me, coming from the sort of HIV world originally, is really the lack of the RCTs of antiviral therapy in those with low level viremia, early fibrosis stages, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. And then the need for other cohort studies for other questions. In terms of the PMTCT, given that we now have this potential expansion and simplification of access to antiviral prophylaxis, really looking at feasibility, the effectiveness and cost effectiveness of either the DNA driven or the universal approach in the context of timely birth dose or not, looking at issues of adherence, discontinuation rates, and the consequences of discontinuing between pregnancy. And then importantly, looking at those ANC service delivery models, simplified service delivery models, ideally as part of a triple elimination agenda with HIV, syphilis, and hepatitis B. Then in terms of children and adolescents, really a much better understanding of the burden, the routes of transmission, prevalence and progression of liver fibrosis, validating the non-invasive tests in the adolescents, and then doing the long-term follow-up studies, looking at the impact of treatment on key outcomes, and very importantly,
on monitoring the kidney and bone health with treatment initiation and optimizing adherence. So just to finish with on the service delivery, I think you'll all be aware of the recommendations that were made in 2022, where we had some very specific recommendations informed by an evidence base on the decentralization of Hep C testing and treatment, ideally at the same site, integrating that into existing services, be it primary care, harm reduction, and the task sharing to non-specialists and nurses. And we did have a good evidence base. We had 142 studies in a systematic review, 33 from 33 countries, which really showed strong, compelling evidence for increased uptake of viral load, and also good data on acceptability from a range of end users. With hepatitis B, we are not in that position. And this is just a snapshot from one of the systematic reviews we did on Hep B service delivery. There were 69 studies, no randomized trials, all single observational studies. And the main message here from this traffic lights was really looking across the cascade where we had data, that's in green, where we didn't have data. And the latter part of the cascade was really was a striking paucity of data. And the main message here, this just shows the cascade of care, those in hospital specialist care models, primary care models, those on antiviral, not on antiviral, is the very significant attrition across the cascade, which really is a priority going forward. So I think my last slide is that because we lacked that very formal evidence base, the approach in these new guidelines is good practice principles. So promoting the adherence, promoting the retention, and moving towards establishing the evidence base for the simplified service delivery. So the key message on the service delivery is we need more methodologically rigorous studies comparing packages of different service delivery models, with describing those models well and capturing the outcomes across the entire continuum of care. And importantly, looking at the interventions already well established in HIV care that can be applied to hepatitis B, strategies to promote and sustain long-term adherence, strategies to promote retention in care and re-engage those lost for care. And then in terms of models, really starting to move to looking at some integrated care models, be it with HIV services, primary care, decentralization, and also task shifting. So I think just to promote the session we have on Saturday, Saeed Hamid, who is the co-chair of the Guidelines Development Group, will be chairing the session with me, and we have a great panel, many of you in this room, who will be participating in that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Questions for Philippa? Yes, thank you.
Kim Owen from Myanmar. Dr. Brooke, we are very excited and very happy to see the newly developed WHO guidelines, especially focusing on the low-income countries. However, even among the low-income countries like Myanmar and Cambodia and Bangladesh and some of the African countries, there can be very, very different and very great social, political, financial, and healthcare system differences. So I still feel that is it a very useful WHO guideline? Using that background, like we did in our country a few years back, we tried to develop a local hepatitis B guidance or guideline developed by in collaboration with the country WHO office and the Ministry of Health and the hepatologists or associations. So, what do you think? I still feel that we still need a locally tailored relevant guideline, in spite of basing upon the WHO main guideline. You would like to have your comments.
Thank you very much. I mean, I think the vision is always that the WHO guidelines provide the foundation for then countries to adapt them, either in their entirety or particular sections and modified at country level. So that is probably the top priority going forward, is to seamlessly move towards adoption of national guidelines based for the low and middle income countries based on the WHO guidelines, and to make that as simple and straightforward as possible. These guidelines are intended to be much simplified. I mean, we do away, as we did in 2015, with all the language about E antigen positive, negative, immune active. All that terminology is gone, and it's largely based on really simple criteria, particularly focused on the APRI and, you know, significant fibrosis, because we want those tools that are readily available in those countries to make the process of determining who should be prioritized for treatment as painless as possible. So we're looking for champion countries who can be the early adopters and recognize there are still many challenges ahead. And I do think the issue of adherence and retention is a critical one. Because looking at the data that we've seen so far, that I think things are rather worse than we perhaps expected. There's obviously a selection bias in those studies that we've seen. It's not truly representative of the overall experience, but it's a sort of a little worrisome quite how low the retention and care rates were.
Thank you. Thank you, Philippa. We'll have a little more time on the panel discussion to explore this in a little more detail. So thank you again. Now I'm going to turn to Ms. Tsuko Yonezawa, who is the representative of the Japanese Hepatitis Council in Tokyo. She's been a part of that organization for quite some time, serving as Secretary General. She's also been a member of the Tokyo Metropolitan Council for Viral Hepatitis Countermeasures and hosts a monthly radio program on liver disease. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm Atsuko Yonezawa.
Today I will be translating for her. So I am the Koko from Hiroshima University.
HBV, HCV virus 排除の重要性について私たちが考えていることというお話をします。私たちは50年前に発足した当事者団体です。
So my name is Asuko Yonezawa, representing the Japan Hepatitis Council and serving as a Secretary General of the Tokyo Hepatitis Association. And our patient association was established 50 years ago.
私は C 型肝炎で2008年にインターフェロン治療によりウイルス排除に成功しました。激しい副作用のため治療と仕事の両立ができず、治療途中に仕事を辞めてしまいました。その後、現在まで患者会で活動しています。
So she was infected with hepatitis C and she received interferon therapy for 1.5 years in 2008 and successfully achieved the viral eradication. But she was suffer severe side effect and she was unable to balance the treatment with her work. So she decided to resign from her job in the midway of the treatment.And from then, so she starts actively contributing in the patient association until now.
患者会活動を始めてから16年間、私たちの仲間を含めて、たくさんの C 型肝炎患者が 肝がんや肝不全のために亡くなっていきました。その多くがインターフェロン治療が効かなかったり受けられなかった高齢者でした。
So, since she involved in many activity in the patient association for 16 years, and many hepatitis C patients, including her colleague, and has passed away due to the liver cancer or liver failure. And most of them were elderly patients who either did not respond to or could not undergo the interferon therapy.
日本で2014年から始まった DAA 治療が私たち C 型肝炎患者の世界を一変させました。特に日本では副作用のために治療できなかった多くの高齢の患者がウイルス排除に成功しました。この感染症に何十年も苦しんできた患者たちの喜びようは例えようのないものでした。
So after introducing of DAA therapy in Japan in 2014,The world of hepatitis C patients like her was completely changed, and particularly in Japan, many elderly patients who were unable to undergo the previous interferon therapy because of the side effect or the other, so all achieved successful viral elimination after the, because of the DAA therapy.So the joint full of the patient who suffer from this interferon for the decay is very incredible.
もちろんウイルスがなくなっても肝硬変はすぐには治りませんし、現在肝がんの再発に苦しむ高齢の患者はたくさんいます。それでも自分の体の中からウイルスを排除するということは、感染症患者にとってスティグマを拭い去ることができる、この上ない大きな喜びであること。それを私たち C 型肝炎患者は知っています。
So of course, so even though the virus is clear from the body, so sometimes there is a liver cirrhosis or it doesn't heal immediately. And many elderly patients are currently suffering from the sometime recurrent of liver cancer. So the hepatitis C patient,despite the eradication of the virus from their body, it happened because of the DAA. So it is a very joyful and happiness for the hepatitis C patients. And it can help so, to clear the stigma as associated with the infectious disease.
感染症患者は他の疾患の患者とは異なり、病気だけではなく社会の偏見や差別とも戦わなくてはなりません。
Patients suffering from the infectious disease is somehow is different from the other patients who suffer from the non-infectious disease. So that's that infectious disease patients have to battle not only the disease itself, but also confront the societal, prejudice and the discrimination.
B 型肝炎はまだウイルスを排除するに至りません。今もなお社会の偏見や差別に苦しむ患者がたくさんいます。
Still, there are no curative treatment against hepatitis B, so many patients still continue to suffer from the societal prejudice and the discrimination.
中学生の時に母に B 型肝炎だと言われました。私、母も B 型肝炎でした。その時母にこのことは誰にも言ってはいけない。と言われました。それ以来誰かを好きになっても気持ちを伝えたことはありません。このまま一人で生きていくつもりです。
So she would like to talk about the story of one patient. So it is a hepatitis B patient. And during the telephone conversation, he received this message like that. When she was in the junior high school, so my mother told me her mother told me that she has a hepatitis B. So her mother also has a hepatitis B, and she also has a hepatitis B. And at the time,So her mother told me, told her so not to tell about the condition disease to the other. Since then, she has never confessed of her feeling. She never expressed her feeling to the other. And she tried to stay and live alone in the very close like this.
これは私たち患者会への電話相談で ワクチンのない時代に生まれたある患者の言葉です。このような患者は決して多くはありませんが、彼らは B 型肝炎のことを誰にも言えず、今でも一人でひっそりと生きています。
So as I talked before, so this is a statement of the hepatitis B patient who make a telephone conversation to the patient society for her patient's association and talking about her feeling like that.
B 型肝炎患者は核酸アナログ製剤を服用していても肝がんを発症することがあります。彼らは人に感染させてしまう恐怖と肝がんを発症してしまうかもしれない2つの恐怖を感じながら生きています。
So, hepatitis B patient can be made double of the liver cancer, even they are treated with the nucleoside analog drug. And they are trying to live with the fear of infecting to the other. They are always afraid they were made to transmit to the other, and there are possibility of developing the liver cancer.
B 型肝炎患者がウイルスを排除することができたら、C 型肝炎患者と同様にスティグマを脱ぎ去ることができて、社会の偏見や差別とも戦わずに済むのです。早くそんな日が来ることを私たち肝炎患者は願っています。
So like the hepatitis C, which can be eradicated clear by the DAA treatment, if hepatitis B can be as the cure and clearly clear by the any kind of the treatment, so it will be very happy. And the hepatitis B patient also free from the stigma and the discrimination, the same like the hepatitis C, they are very less stigma and discrimination compared to hepatitis B. And so when no longer have to face a societal prejudice and discrimination. So she, the whole organization, the hoping like the hepatitis patient, that this kind of day to come, like the hepatitis B can be clear as well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions?
Yes, I think that this is excellent expression from a person who is really affected by the problems. You talk about a clear of hepatitis B, and I think that it's always from my student days to talk about surface antigen positivity. But from our understanding, hepatitis B cannot be clear. Even if you turn surface antigen negative, we have reactivations for hepatitis B. Well, especially those patients treated with immunosuppressive therapy. I just wonder whether you, I mean, from the layperson point perspective, you really have the understanding what clear means. Or is it just surface antigen? Because from a medical point of view, we see a lot of surface antigen positive negative patients. Who reactivate. Hepatitis C didn't reactivate. So I think this needs to be straightened out, not to talk about some markers or whether it is really the issues. Maybe I want to hear from a layperson and perspective, because this will reorientate our entire perspective. Maybe, I mean, just open for discussions. Okay. So do you know surface antigen, you mean clear, it means surface antigen? You do know that surface antigen negative patients can reactivate and hepatitis C will not reactivate?
S 抗原を抑える。なくなることです。はい。なくなること。ウイルス排除する。なくなることです。
So she thought that the clearance means that the virus is totally disappear from the body.
Well, but this is in reality never happens. That's the problem. So I think that's why, I mean, this is very important. from people like us who has been working on the science and as a doctors, and to talk about this to a lay person, because they think that it could be clear. It's not whether it's, it cannot be clear. It's a durable sustained disease remissions, but they can reactivate. The virus is there. Even in those patients who have cleared the surface antigens, the HPV DNA integrated, and we can reactivate them. And this is a very important message. And we have to, I think this bring up issues, maybe a barrier.
Thank you again. Thank you. Thank you again very much. Let's turn to Dr. Saeed Hamid. Saeed is the professor of the Department of Medicine and director of the Clinical Trials Unit at the Aga Khan University in Karachi, Pakistan. He has many appointments with professional associations, and I think importantly has served as chair of the WHO guideline committee for both hepatitis C and hepatitis B, Saeed. And I have to say, I want to thank Saeed for being a member of our technical advisory board for the coalition. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John and George. I think this is a great initiative coming together of the APASL elimination group with Dr. John Ward's group. I've been involved with his group for quite some time now, and I see how active they have become within the last few years. It really is the blazing a trail. So I hope that this collaboration will continue and will prosper and will impact the Asia Pacific region in general. So thank you very much for your kind invitation. So I'm just going to very quickly speak about achievements and prospects of eliminating viral hepatitis in Pakistan. You've already heard a number of times that Pakistan is now the epicenter, well, the biggest burden country in the world, with roughly 10 million people infected, out of which about 7 to 8 million are viremic patients. So this is the largest burden that we carry. It is not just that, it is also the fact that our infection seems to be increasing. So if you look at our two major provinces, Punjab and Sindh, the Punjab province has gone from 6.7 in 2.8 in 2008 to 8.9, nearly 9% in 2018, and Sindh has gone from 5 to 6.1. We don't have good data from the other two provinces, but this will probably reflect in the same way. So the infection is still on the increase, which means that we are getting new infections very regularly and very frequently. So just to put it in lay terms, and some of these slides have been used to talk to the policymakers. Every 20 minutes, a Pakistani dies of hepatitis C related complications, either liver cirrhosis and liver cancer, and there are approximately 20,000 new liver cancer cases added every year. Since we are in Japan, I thought we would very quickly just talk about this study. This we did many years ago with Masashi, with Professor Mizukami, and this looked at a molecular and a clock analysis work in order to try and define how did we get here where we are. And molecular clock analysis basically depends on the evolutionary distances of these various strains that you see here from Pakistan. So to cut a long story short, this is how it translates into the trajectory of the infection. And we gained our independence in 1947, somewhere around here. And the first, this is how the trajectory has gone. And what we then did was try to juxtapose some of the actions that happened during this time to try and explain this. So we had the first five-year health action plan, which was announced around 1955 and so on. And this entailed a lot of various vaccinations that are available, including the smallpox vaccination. And then there was a concerted smallpox vaccination campaign from 1964 to 1982. And then following on from that, there was, of course, political unrest, where we had a huge influx of 5 to 6 million refugees from Afghanistan, which was in the mid 70s. And we think these are the elements that have really established the large burden that we have in the country.
Having said that, we also know that we are big injectors, the population, about 16 average injections per person per year. This has obviously improved significantly in the last few years, but the EMRO region in general and some particularly in countries in particular remain very much affected for this. But now let's turn to the good side. And we have to say that Pakistan has made, under the circumstances, Pakistan has made reasonable progress towards hepatitis C elimination. If you look at 2015 data, we were about 10 million patients who were possibly viremic. There has been a cumulative diagnosis of about 30% of these people, and 16% have been so far treated. Now, these are numbers which come from private enterprises, private clinics, private hospitals treating, and then some of the provincial programs that are treating. Our health is devolved into provinces. The federal government controls a small amount of it, particularly the policy making and so on. But the provinces are the ones that are delivering. So it's a devolved system, which has its benefits as well as its caveats. What has helped in this, in all this progress that we've made, particularly in terms of elimination, is the availability, DAA availability. As early as February 16, we got generic sabosavir, which was about $20 a month, still reasonably okay for us. And then we got the soft tech combination in January 17, which was $30 a month. And then Softvel came in January 18. And these are the two main combinations that we have at the moment. The current prices, despite all the currency fluctuations or the expensiveness of the IP and so on, we still can deliver treatment of SoftDAC for $18 a month and SoftVel for $36 a month. So as you can see, obviously our treatment of choice is still SoftDAC, although many people do not think that this is a good pan-genotypic drug. But I'll show you some data which really bears our point forward. Now, there has been at least three major announcements of a national, mega national hepatitis elimination program, and we are still waiting to see one really kick into top gear. One such announcement was in 2019 on the World Hepatitis Day. This is the country's president who's on the podium and the country's prime minister who's seated, who announced this major program, which still hasn't seen the light of the day, I'm afraid. And this has now been superseded by the latest program that we have, which is 2023 to 2030. It is an ambitious program. I'll show you the numbers. The money has been approved. This is 35 billion PKR, which translates to less than $1 billion, to about between $500 to $700 million for the whole program, which really isn't much. And it is just strange that these things are not happening at the moment. I was just talking to Jacob, and I said in Pakistan we were able to put hepatitis C into the disease priority list only about 3 to 4 years ago. The government has a disease priority list of various things that they want to do, and HCV came in only about 4 years ago. So the Federation will contribute 35 billion PKR. This is committed. The provinces shall enhance their funding to match the federal funds. They already have a lot of funding in their programs, and they should be able to do this quite easily. This is not a vertical program, but it is an add-on. And the main function of the federal government would be purchasing, single purchaser, RDTs, PCRs, medicines, and supply them to the provinces on a need basis. And we hope that once this kickstarts, we will get significant funding from external donors. Please ignore the tables. These are just not meant for description. But look at the main objectives. The objective is to screen 50%, which means 69 million of eligible patients in the aged more than 12 years in the next 5 years. Test all screened positive individuals, which is about 5.15 million for infection, and treat all population, which is about 4.12 million
in this period. And then there'll be a second phase where we try and mop up whatever is left. This is a slide from Homi Razavi. You've seen some of this before. Just look at the bottom line. If we diagnosed 90% of all infections and treat 80% of the diagnosis cases by 2030, we reduce the total infections by -7.1 new infections by lower than 1.5 million. 482 cases of cirrhosis are averted, 92,000 liver cancer is averted, and 136,000 deaths are averted. So this is not rocket science that with this, if we do nothing, this is the cost of inaction. If we do nothing, we go up to something like 11% of prevalence, and this really will be hard to control. However, if we do something right now, we can really, and this will be a loss to the GDP of the tune of $3 billion. And this is what the policymakers have to understand. We hope that they have understood. That's why the money is committed, and we will start to get better with this years of lives lost and years of living with disability. If we move on immediately, coming to hepatitis B, this is I'm sorry to say, but this is a slightly less prioritized disease for us because the burden of hepatitis C is so much. Even then, there's 2.5% prevalence of hepatitis B in Pakistan, 30,000 new infections, and about 12,000 HPV-related deaths in 2019. And I'm showing you the National Hepatitis Elimination Program of the profile of the CGHE, which is quite good in this sense. These are the numbers that are given and from the government programs, and the hepatitis B programs are mainly run by the government programs. The private sector does not get too involved in this because the treatment is infinite, and therefore many of the private programs are not able to sustain this. If you look at the government figures, there is 50% coverage of the birth dose vaccine. Now, we as academics take this with a little bit of pinch of salt, but these are the figures. Well, let's say even if it is 10% or 15% lower, at least we've got about 30% to 35% coverage. The difficulty is not in the procurement. It used to be a procurement difficulty because Gavi will not support the hepatitis B single birth dose program. It now does. And now it is more of an implementation issue that we have to really focus on. We do very well with the hepatitis B adult or catch-up vaccination program. That's not the problem, but the diagnosis is rather poor. Remember, I showed you the figure of 30% for diagnosis of hepatitis B. It is only 14% for diagnosis of hepatitis C. And the numbers tested, somebody asked, I think Dr. Wynn asked what happened during COVID. We went down from nearly 1 million tests in 2018 to just 350,000 tests in 2020. And the number of persons treated obviously, of course, went down significantly. So in conclusion, Pakistan has the highest HCV infected population, about 10 million cases. We add at least 100,000 cases, new cases per year. This is obviously modeling. We don't have very good incidence data. That's a problem. But modeling can suggest anywhere between 100,000 new cases to 300,000 new cases. There's a need to work on disease prevention alongside diagnosis and treatment. Challenges are many, but can be addressed with the joint efforts of all stakeholders. And the private sector engagement can really make a difference. And I think together we can eliminate hepatitis C from Pakistan, maybe not by 2030, but maybe by 2035, maybe by 2040. Even if we do it in 2040, we will be a happy lot. Thank you.
Hey, Saeed, one question, anyone? Very quickly, you had that disturbing trend that the number of people, the prevalence is going up of hepatitis C. Some of that, you have a big force of infection because people aren't getting treated. You still have many people that have been treated. At the same time, there's a big need to improve infection control in hospitals, et cetera? I mean, how is that going in Pakistan, would you think?
Well, it's not going well, John, because I think that is very much policy driven and very much implementation driven, and the government has to do this. The policies are there, even the laws are there, which don't seem to be implemented as much as possible. So I think that is where there's a bit of a struggle.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Thank
we'll
you.
Move on. Thank you again, Saeed. Okay, let's move on to Professor Janice Ong. She's a gastroenterologist, transplant hepatologist, and researcher from the Philippines. And
thank you.
We welcome him to the program. Thank you, Janice. Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning, and oh, good afternoon already.
Nope, not quite.
Not morning. Yeah. So it's an honor to be here to present on behalf of our team, and the topic assigned was decentralizing care for Hep B and Hep C research priorities. I'm a clinician mainly working now in dabbling in operational research. This is just a snapshot of the Philippines. It's a classified as a lower middle income country with about 115 million people. And we have about, latest modeling, 5% Hep B, or about 5.6 million infected with hepatitis B, and less than 1% with Hep C, or about 400,000 with infected with hepatitis C. And as you can see from the cascade of care, very few have been diagnosed, and even fewer have been treated. And this is the our progress towards our elimination targets. We do okay with respect to vaccination and as well as blood safety and injection safety, but we really are struggling with the diagnosis and treatment. This is such a slide to show the challenges in achieving elimination goals in the country, and it's a long list. And first, we don't really have a costed national action plan. There was a draft, but it never materialized. Hopefully we can get that done. The lack of validated data. We are now doing a seroprevalence survey, our first after so many years. Hopefully we will have some good data at the end of the year. Except for some demonstration sites in several provinces of the Department of Health, diagnostics and treatment are really out of pocket for Hep B and Hep C. There's also a lack of accessible diagnostic centers, especially for viral load testing. There's also a lack of awareness among the general and affected population, as well as healthcare providers and, importantly, policymakers. There is, as mentioned before, significant stigma and discrimination, and there is a lack of adequately trained healthcare workers for viral hepatitis. Care is, I think, like many low to middle income countries, delivered by specialists in large urban centers. So there are a lot of opportunities with respect to implementing operational research here, and I was assigned to talk about decentralization. And so why do we decentralize care for Hep B and Hep C? Well, ideally, the care, the entire cascade of care from diagnosis to treatment to monitoring and long-term care could be provided in one setting. I think Dr. Nguyen had mentioned this. But in reality, a majority of patients actually have to travel to 3 to 4 sites to complete the cascade of care. And we lose patients this way. And this has been identified as a major pain point by patients during our research on patient journey mapping. And this is, you know, magnified in a country like the Philippines, which is an archipelago of more than 7,600 islands. About 2,000 inhabited with more than 19 regional languages. And really care delivered by specialists, and there are very few of them, about 600 gastroenterologists and maybe about 400 infectious disease specialists, and not all of them actually are treating hepatitis. So I just wanted to share what project we're doing. So I'm speaking first, and then my colleague from Vietnam will be speaking after. We're trying to do a model of care in the Philippines as well as in Vietnam, because we thought that if we were to improve the diagnosis, care, and treatment of hepatitis, we need to improve access, utilization, and quality, improve participation, health literacy, and care seeking, and improve determinants of health. And to do that, we need to really invest in the primary healthcare system, you know, decentralized care, and we need political commitment, policy frameworks, a lot of funding and resources, and community healthcare worker engagement. And so our own little contribution to this would be the STITCH project, the Strengthening Integrated Treatment and Care for Hepatitis, which is a project that we are working together with several groups, the Department of Health, the Central Luzon Department of Health, the Harvard Medical School, as well as HIVN in Vietnam, and the province of Tarlac, which is our pilot site. And this is working together to invest in the primary healthcare system. The province that we're working in right now is the province of Tarlac. So the project is a six-phase project, and it involves a lot of research within the entire project. We started out with preparing, and then we conducted research on patient journey mapping, which we will soon hopefully publish. And then we had a landscape mapping as well as health facility assessment. And using all of the information that we got from all of those research and work, we then moved on to the co-design of the model of care, which really involved a lot of the patients, because we believe in, you know, putting the patients at the center of this model of care. So just some photos on what happened. We engaged with national, regional, and local authorities and various stakeholders. Our project research results on patient journey mapping as well as health facility assessment, we presented to another group of stakeholders and validated this last year. Using that, we then held two co-design, or three actually, co-design workshop series, where we went through a process of identifying the interventions that we needed to include in the package of interventions for the model of care that we hope to pilot, which we are piloting now, starting 2024. So this is a very complicated slide on the model of care, which, as you can see, involves the entire treatment cascade. And on the bottom of the slide are the various intervention areas that we hope to implement to achieve the outcomes. It prioritizes 12 interventions in four key areas: optimization of clinical pathway and linkage, to build healthcare worker capacity, improve facility and system readiness, and to activate and engage the people and community in the entire process. So what are we doing now? We are currently testing the model of care in the province of Tarlac, and we are constantly monitoring the progress and reviewing. This April, we will have our quarterly review and hopefully address pain points that have arisen, because there are, of, as you can imagine, and lessons learned, and formulate solutions if we can to them. And what we hope to do next after the implementation would be gathering the data and then hopefully scaling a improved model of care to another province. So I guess what other research priorities would be optimal to drive more decentralized services? I'm sure there's the CGHE document on a roadmap for operational research, but formative research that look at the acceptability and optimization of decentralized services from the end users, surveys and focus group discussions with patients and healthcare providers. Modeling of cost effectiveness of decentralized models of care for viral hepatitis, because I think it's good to have a model of care, but we need to be able to finance and have a financial package or a insurance package for this, so that it's the only way really to sustain diagnosis and treatment. And while our group is not able to do this, but hopefully a comparative trial, you know, evaluating the effectiveness of a newer model of care that is primary care and non-specialist compared to a usual care with a traditional specialist driven care of viral hepatitis. So with that, that's my last slide, and thank you very much from the also to our team for the tremendous help in putting this together. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Thank you. Excellent. I think we're any questions quickly? All right, well, let's move on, since you mentioned the collaborative project in Vietnam. Let's go on and hear from Dr. Pham Thanh Thuy, who is the was the vice director of the Department of Infectious Diseases at Bac Mai Hospital in Hanoi, Vietnam, and she's also participating in the project that Janice mentioned in collaboration with Harvard University to seek ways of simplifying and decentralizing hepatitis B care in the Philippines and in Vietnam. Dr. Thuy.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. And thank you so much for giving me the chance to share with you on how we are using the implementation research to develop a care model for HBV and HCV care in Vietnam through our partnership with Harvard Medical School, the Ministry of Health in Vietnam, Gilead Science, and other and communities for this work. This is my disclaimer. For the objectives, I hope that by the end of this talk, I will share with you all these objectives, primarily showing that to demonstrate that people-centered care is possible through the research implementation in the field. Let's start with the viral hepatitis burden in our country with the data from the Polaris. And you can see here that for HCV, the diagnosis is very low in our country, and even lower is the number of persons with hepatitis C access to treatment resulted in the one death in every 2 hours. And this is not good because this is the infection that can be cured. For the hepatitis B, the number is about 42% diagnosed, but our experience is it can be much lower than reported here. And even lower is the number of person getting to the treatment. It says about the gap from the linkage from the diagnosis to treatment, and it resulted in the death of HBV infected patients is five times outnumbered the HCV patient. So you can see here that Vietnamese government is trying to combat with the hepatitis B and C and other chronic diseases in Vietnam. Our policies go very closely after the WHO recommendations. Either it is the technical guidance or the policy changes. But our what we can see, our experience in reality, is that we still have many implementation barriers and the gaps of the payment for coverage for the screening, diagnosis, and treatment for both these diseases in Vietnam. It results in the services remaining primarily concentrated at central and provincial level and led by specialists rather than primary care. And not many people can access to diagnosis and treatment. For the health insurance, you know, it's challenges in screening, diagnosis, and also DAA and the coverage for treatment as well. The HCV patients have to pay up to $600 per 3 months cost of DAAs, and this is not affordable for many, and they cannot access to the treatment. To bridging the gaps between the policies and the care, so we partner with many with the different partners, as you can see here, academia, the government, the healthcare facilities, the private sectors, to provide the person care for hepatitis at the primary level. And we undergone many stages, as Dr. Zhang shared with you. And here are the areas that we focus on after very long stages or many meetings and workshops working on the model of care. And the idea of the optimizing clinical care pathway is providing the care for patients with hepatitis to address all the barriers in the care pathway. So and employing all the levels to help people with hepatitis getting the right care, at right place at the right time. So to have that done, so we build capacity of primary healthcare through training and also technical assistance throughout the implementation process. We improve the facility. We help improve facility and system readiness, getting them ready for the service, and also help the community community to be educated on the diseases, as well to employ the community help through this on processes. One very important thing of the project is evaluate the care model. And Dr. Zhang has already presented in the initial stages studies that we have done, and from now on we will do more things on evaluating the impact and associations of the model of care on the cascade of care, patient experience, facility readiness, and provider competency, and very importantly, cost of the model of care. And this is the snapshot of the dashboard that we have, saying that we just recently started, and this is very still primary, but we will use this dashboard to ensure the quality improvement continuously to help the all the stakeholders to do the quality improvement to get better care for people at the primary care. And in the future, we will use our data, the things we learn from the project to inform the policy and help expand the model of care for hepatitis to other localities as well to other diseases as well. So we strongly believe that through the implementation research, bringing the services closer to the to people in need with the people-centered approach at primary care, we will actually accelerate the implementation and bring the elimination goal of hepatitis faster than is expected with our current pace. So I'd like to thank our STITCH team for doing a great job in this, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, Janice, if you will be so kind as to come back up to the podium, we're going to do a little bit of a hybrid panel discussion here in the interest of time. I think your project is really important because we're talking a lot about decentralization, simplification for hepatitis B, and I think you're really seeking to do that here. And I just wanted to take about 5 to 10 minutes and explore some aspects of your project. And Dr. Tui, you can sit here too if you'd like, or you can stand at the podium. But being too, let me just kick it off by being two specialists, one in infectious disease and one in hepatology. What have been some of your early learnings as you've been beginning to interact more broadly with primary care clinicians? What do you see? Is it just strictly a financial, issue that we can, get more services supported, more work will be done, or is there more research that would be helpful to really tailor, as was mentioned by a colleague from Myanmar, coming up with more tailored approaches to fit different situations? That's, have any thoughts about that?
In terms of implementing hepatitis B models of care, I think it's really difficult. I mean, in the Philippines, we heard Professor Saeed mention, how do you get the government to be interested in hepatitis programs? And that's been a struggle, which we have been able to have, these small wins, and we do have some budget, but we don't really have a clear line item budget for hepatitis. In terms of the healthcare worker and the primary care delivery of hepatitis care, I think we really need to do a lot more in terms of healthcare capacity building. Hep B, unlike hepatitis C, is much more complex in terms of management, and the simplification that will come with the WHO guidelines, although our own Hep B guidelines have been simplified actually as well, that will be a big help to really get more primary care physicians and to be engaged in care. But I think the other thing that we really need to focus on is trying to limit the number of visits that a patient has to go through, as mentioned by Dr. Nguyen. They get screened and then diagnosed and then treated in the same place rather than being sent all over the place for you know, referral and then testing, etc.
I would like to talk from the to share from the perspective of the clinical work. So for the primary health providers, they are very reluctant from the beginning because they have limited knowledge about the disease and do not know how to manage. And by the regulations in Vietnam perspective, you know, they must go through many instances to get the service approved. With the help from our project, we get on this, and we can see that they are very excited about this, about, you know, having the possibilities, capacities to do that. And we hope that when they are involving in the job, you know, in the work of actually providing the care, they will be more confident and happier to do that. They can definitely do that.
Thank you. So there needs to be some real system change to help simplify as well. George, I don't know if you had a question.
Yeah, I think that this session is really very interesting, but I would like to ask one question. Do you have an estimate of how much it would cost to treat and to implement therapy on those who need to be treated in your country? So what is the financial implications? Because different countries have different GDPs and the cost is different. Do you have any estimate? I think sometimes in real life, at the end of the day, is the cost and whether you can afford it. Well, we just can't afford something which is fancy and when we have to come back to real life. So is there any attempt to understand the financial implications? And then we can talk about the financial gain if you invest those type of money. I mean, so is there any attempts to do this?
Yeah, you're right. I think the it's good to have a model of care and see if it works. If it works, we really need to be able to sustain it. And the only way to sustain it is to have a package and have it financed by insurance. So part of the research that we will be doing would be modeling the cost effectiveness. We will first cost out the interventions both in the two countries, and then I think we've engaged a group to help us in modeling the cost of the interventions and then the potential implications of such a model of care when implemented nationwide. Yeah.
Yeah, I would add that in Vietnam, the health insurance will be the resource for covering. Currently, the health insurance is most disease oriented. So, but through the model of care, we cannot now save the cost of the care, but we hope to show how the early diagnosis when patients people are not symptomatic, you know, is benefit in the spending instead of end disease spending. Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is very important. I really encourage the Asia Pacific regions to have individuals assessment, and then we can come together to understand each other.
Hello, Kamal from Myanmar. I really would like to share our experience. In my country, we cannot expect the government for the funding. At the same time, we cannot invite the international donors. So we have our own Myanmar GI and Liver Foundation. We put billionaires and millionaires in the our patron group. And we did everything by ourselves. We designed the priorities. For example, in Myanmar, by the age of adolescent, we need to shave your hand and become VIP, a monk. It's a compulsory. That's very dangerous for the spreading of the hepatitis B. So we focus on the monks. This year, we are going to vaccinate 100,000 monks vaccination with our own funding. Our own means not own. We make it popular among the public that I want to donate on my birthday 1 million chats to the foundation, something like that. The thing is that you really cannot be relying upon the governments all the time. At the same time, you are not supposed to be expecting the foreign donors, which again is not possible in my country. So you cannot do this, you cannot do that, you cannot, and you just sit down and depress. No, you cannot. You have to do something. So we did our own foundation. We looked for the funds by ourselves, not from the government. And being in the foundation, we are a little bit free from the government. If you're in the Myanmar Medical Association, you need to report everything to the minister. Being in the foundation, we are free. We do whatever we want. That's how we are surviving and moving. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much for that information that shows how capacity building is going forward in Myanmar. I did have one question about the engagement of community in your efforts. So I'm familiar with the Yellow Warriors, for example, in the Philippines. So just please describe the engagement of community organizations in your projects.
So yes, we do have a patient organization called the Yellow Warriors Society of the Philippines. And they have been very active. And I've worked with them through, I think, many, many years of trying to convince the government. For our project, we have made sure that we have engaged them from the start during the research part on patient journey mapping in particular to help identify patients in the area of the pilot site to interview. And then when we got the results, we validated it with their group as well in attendance in the validation workshop. And then in the co-design process, they were in all the subcommittees to look at the different interventions and give the patient perspective on the interventions.
For Vietnam, we still do not have that, but we have good lessons from the community-based organizations supporting HIV implementation program. Currently, we have involved women, labor organizations in this job, and hope that we will expand, starting from the information education campaign first.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for coming up and talking
you.
A little bit
Excellent.
More about the project. Thank you. You know, I started this off this morning just in to comment that in the history of disease elimination, of which hepatitis elimination is now becoming a part of, you know, it's national commitment is as important as technical know-how to get everything moving. And we've touched on why that's important as we've celebrated successes in hepatitis elimination variety of countries, recognizing ongoing challenges, and how political commitment, including at the community level, is really and really important. And I have to say, as someone moving from the US CDC for many years, while I was involved in policy development and tracking disease trends and doing research, and moving over to a nonprofit organization where we're still doing those types of things, but increasingly I recognize that we have to be strong, vocal advocates to get that national commitment moving around the world. And we've heard examples of that going on already today. It's really great to hear from a patient perspective, the role of academics, the role of industry, and the role of professional associations such as APASL, because it's going to take us all to have a strong chorus calling for that action, letting the right stakeholders know why they need to be at the table, why hepatitis B and hepatitis C elimination is feasible moving forward. So the coalition, in collaboration with the task force for viral hepatitis elimination of APASL that George represents, we have put together a call to action that you know, recognizes that we have these elimination goals, that we have achievements to celebrate, you know, models of national programs. We heard from countries like Japan and Australia here today, achievements such as hepatitis B vaccination, coverage improvement strategies and technologies that make a robust toolkit for hepatitis C elimination, and prospects for functional cures, new policies of reduced cost of treatments, et cetera, that paved the way for expanding access for hepatitis B and C treatment. However, you know, we have some challenges that we're seeking to address and make better known to all stakeholders, so that we can achieve gains in health and also in productivity. So tomorrow, when we have a more formal signing ceremony, we're going to be calling on governments to improve the quality of their data and quality of their planning, maintaining interventions that are achieving elimination, such as hepatitis B birth dose vaccination, update policies so that you can expand access to testing and treatment, and to continue to reduce the modes of transmission, such as for risk populations, such as persons who inject drugs, and really seek to engage all stakeholders, you know, in that effort. For clinicians and for organizations like APASL, bring in other clinicians to help them become providers of prevention and care for hepatitis B and hepatitis C. Provide the expertise to inform guideline development, and strive to integrate hepatitis B and hepatitis C care and treatment throughout health systems, while recognizing the critical role of specialists for complicated cases and to serve as mentors for others. And always to be a participant in operational research, but we always can improve the quality of our work, and be a part of the communities of practice, such as represented here today, to share lessons learned. For communities, it's really important for us to convene as local coalitions to bring all those stakeholders with the resources and expertise to make hepatitis elimination possible, be a vocal voice, loud voice for raising awareness of the threat of hepatitis and the benefits of hepatitis elimination, and seeking to reduce stigma so that the benefits of knowing your status and getting to care exceed the risk. And then all of us, recognizing our respective roles in this effort, come together in a unity of purpose with a shared commitment of working together till goals for hepatitis B and hepatitis C elimination are achieved. that's, I think, that's what I see, and I think the task force sees is a strong call to action. I hope all of you, agree with that. We're going to have an opportunity to for you to sign on. Please, beginning right now, please click on that QR code and just send in your signature or your electronically. The more, the better. If your organization, your government, WHO can be a prominent sign on to this. We want to send a strong message that we are united as clinicians, health officials, community members, academicians, and industry. We all know that hepatitis elimination is feasible and we can be achieved, and we're all committed to those goals. Please join us tomorrow in this room. Is that right, Lindsay? Yep. What room is it? It's in room 9 tomorrow afternoon at 1:40. So come about 1:30. Join us up on the stage and show your presence and your commitment as a individually and as an organization to this call to action to eliminate hepatitis. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you again for coming. George, I'll let you say some final remarks and then adjourn.
Well, I can't say anything to add, but this is why we are all here. We want to relieve the suffering from our patients, and viral hepatitis is so important in Asia-Pacific regions, and welcome the efforts from you guys and also WHO over here. So do come tomorrow, 1:30, room 9.
Thank you.
And show your support.
And thanks again to Gilead Sciences for making this convening possible. Thank you again.
Thanks for the support.